show you two video clips. One of them is real and one of them is fake. Look at these two clips. One of them is real and one of them is fake. Can you tell which one it is?
The dangers of AI, artificial intelligence.
The threat AI poses to the social.
I've never seen it quite like this.
This technology is spreading rapidly.
It's really
mind-blowing.
Deep fakes.
Deep Tom Cruise was a tipping point for deep fakes.
We're increasingly in a world where AI is everywhere, but do we actually know what's really going on? Let's dig into what AI really is with me, Crystal Wijaya, at Kailas Bhatkar. Yeah, AI has actually been around for many years now. Coming from the tech field, I started doing machine learning with a Python script in my laptop maybe 20 years ago. But today, we're increasingly exposed to AI in the wild being things like in our news, on Twitter, social media. We have to ask ourselves, is this post real or did someone deepfake this? And the paradigm is moving so quickly that it's hard to tell what we can trust anymore. Coming from tech, I know how AI works. I know when to be suspicious. When we see AI now controlling things like spam or fraud and risk, we start to see AI doing scarier things. And so I'd like to dive into what are the actual mechanics behind AI. AI at its front is really just machine learning applied. Machine learning has the ability to create, reason, and infer, and listen to data around it. And what comes out is the ability to create new journalistic interviews like this, or scripts might be researched by AI, or you might see photos that never actually existed but were created by a generative AI product. And that might be scary. We see companies cutting jobs and saying you can be replaced by AI. Klarna, for example, in the US, replaced its customer service callers with AI service agents, and that can be kind of brutal. We find that you no longer have that human touch anymore. I personally don't think that journalists will be the easiest entity to replace with AI. I think journalism is a media format that requires trust. And frankly, if you think about it, most people don't trust other people. And so why would humans trust machines? Well, if you think about it, AI is the first kind of machine where you've had to doubt what it says. Usually when we're given access to a computer, we can trust that it's going to do what it says it will do because it's been programmed with static data, static information, and frameworks. So we never had to ask ourselves, could the resulting answer be false? But now with generative AI, we do have to ask that question. We have to be a bit skeptical about the results that we are getting from an AI program or an AI that's generating information. And so with journalism, well, at the heart of it, it's a human experience that you have to trust. You have to trust that someone has gone through the facts, has talked to other people on the ground, and picked up on data that isn't really on a spreadsheet. It's not really available in a poll. It's something that you have to talk to humans and ask them how they're feeling about the situation. So journalism, while on its face, you can replace maybe some of the content, you will not get to a place where you have trustworthy AI. And that's something that I think will never change. In tech, we might see companies replacing workers who are able to do kind of simple fact retrieval. So in the legal field, you may have people who are able to pull together cases, but you aren't going to replace the person who has to pour through all of the details and deeply understand it. And in fact, the kind of jobs that are most safe from AI replacing them are jobs where you have to interact with another human being or need to have built trust and empathy with the users. in tech, you might be able to replace an engineer in tech with AI because they've learned to code on the same machines. But how do you replace someone who knows how to sing or dance or create art that is innovative and new? That's not something that AI has the ability to do right now. So I'll talk about there's a maturity with AI and how we are experiencing it in the real world today. If you think about a product like Google Maps, where initially you use it to get a static result from point A to point B, what turns do I make and how long will it take? That used to be a static snapshot from data based on, you know, geographic maps and the static laws of the streets. And then we moved into more predictive data where you were able to consider, you know, an accident might have just happened. And so the map updates itself based on new inputs of data. That would be a reactive data system or a product that, based on a new input, is able to correct its advice. And then we move into generative, kind of predictive mapping, where in Google Maps, it knows that there isn't any traffic right now, you know, on the way home from work, but it does know, based on historical data, that within 30 minutes, there will be about a 10-minute slowdown. And so it adds that into the prediction of how long your route will take to get home before it actually happens. And that ends up being an example of predictive AI. Not all companies have this ability. Not all companies should be embracing AI. We should, like many other things, embrace AI only when it makes sense for our business or for our company's needs. Most companies don't even use the data that they already have today. And so I'll talk to companies who, you know, they understand that users are churning or they're leaving their product, but they don't understand the inputs as to why. And instead, they want a very fancy AI machine learning model to tell them who's going to churn. And I say, great, I'll tell you, this customer right here, they're going to churn. And I know that because, you know, 11% of customers churn on the first day. What are you going to do about it? And they have no answer. And so AI, when used to make predictions without telling you the reasons why it's made that prediction, in the case of most deep learning, isn't that useful. It might help you build a financial model, but it doesn't help you act in the real world. So companies, there are many companies today that survive, not because they have the most data or the cleanest data, but because they are a delightful product. And delight is rare today. You need people to understand and have empathy to have. One, there's the offline services, a therapist, for someone to kind of feel the emotion with you, to hold your hand with you as you are crying through a bad day. That's not something AI is going to be able to do. And if we make a robot out of it, I'm not sure that I'm going to want that hug versus, you know, my parents or a friend. A shoulder to cry on is not going to be replaced by AI. We may make tech-enabled tools that maybe use AI to create better and faster services or matchmaking, but you're not going to have a product whose delightfulness, it's the ability to scroll and see animations, the ability to create characters that you love that are mascots of your app. Think about the last time you scrolled Instagram and you thought to yourself, wow, that's a really cool post, that's a really cool visual. That probably wasn't AI generated, it was probably someone's taste. And taste is something you can't magically create through data. Most people don't have good taste, and as a result, AI is pretty bad taste, it's quite mid. And so if you want to be someone who is irreplaceable, who cannot be replaced by AI, you gotta have really good taste. You'll have to be designed first. That requires human empathy, an ability to understand how the world perceives the products and services that we have to offer, and to make something compelling. For those of us who are in engineering today, or maybe thought, you know, it's a good time to become an engineer, it's still true. It's still true that we need more engineers. It's just that the bar for an engineer has gone a lot higher. It's no longer enough to be able to code or know a library. it's going to be important to be someone who makes thoughtful decisions, that can understand and perceive how the business is moving, what architectural design decisions have been made, and the types of people at the company, whether or not they might like this type of library versus another one. There's never been a better time to be an excellent engineer, is what I tell people. It's a pretty bad time to be an engineer who can only write code, and instead will have to care a lot more about the business. Engineers who only care about code and tech and don't look beyond their scope of work are going to have a really bad time in a world where AI can replace a lot of the functional tasks that we used to do as engineers. And instead, we'll have to do what AI cannot do, which is talk to our customers, try to design a compelling experience, to consider and make decisions on how people will experience our product. And that can be as simple as the vibe that you want your landing page to look like is a decision that most AI leaves up to chance. And if you leave things up to chance, you are no better than an AI system.